Good morning, OGTC and the apparel fraternity of the world. I'm a bit scared sitting here because normally in every session there are three speakers and I am the only one left. And yesterday when I was seeing Mr. Vivek questioning all the speakers that your time is run out and you have only just 2 minutes, I was quite happy and I deleted a lot of my slides yesterday night. Hello. Hello. Yeah. But I'll try to, because today morning Gunish told me that, you know, since the third speaker is yet to arrive, I can take some more time. I have very few slides there, but I'll try to answer, you know, whatever you want. Yesterday, Mr. Uppal was saying that, you know, every year we conduct the OGTC, and if every one of us take a small learning from that, a portion of that, then the purpose of the meeting is done. I was sitting on the other side in the last few conferences, and this time they decided to put me on the stage. They asked, "You are coming from Bangalore all the way. What have you learned? Tell us what have you learned." So I humbly agreed that I will share what I have learned. It's not that we learned. We had implemented a lot of things. And we have got a lot of benefits also. And it is the culture of our organization that whatever we learn, we share. And we also allow people to visit us and see. Very few people in this audience have seen our companies. Mr. Gunish, Mr. Beda. I don't remember much name. Yesterday, Moushmi was here. So, any of you, whenever you are in Bangalore, if you tell us in advance, you are welcome to see our plant. Let me go to the presentation. I feel I am getting glued to this, so I'm not very comfortable standing there. My presentation will be having four small sessions. The first one is about the problem, the issue faced by our company. The second one is what solution we got. And the third one is how did we implement that. And the fourth one is... I think it's okay now. Yeah, I am also a bit relieved because of that change. Our company belongs to the Aditya Birla Group, and as Mr. Gunish said, most of you might know Madura Fashion and Lifestyle from the brands what we make. We are the largest Indian retail company in India, which is producing brands Louis Philippe, Van Heusen, Ellen Solly, Peter England. Madura Clothing is the manufacturing company within the Madura Fashion and Lifestyle, which do most of the manufacturing. The changes in the apparel business environment, which happened, because most of you are aware of that. But I need to mention about that because the context is very relevant here. There was a time when we all go to the retail store, the time when I was young. We go to a Vivaldi showroom or something like that, and you get very limited choice of you know, ready-made garments. So what you do is that you go walk into the stores, and the store guy will tell you that these are the shirts available, you take it. And those time, the MRP used to be 250, 300 rupees. Today, any retail store if you go, you cannot sell what you produce. You need to give what the customer want. So the customer want a lot of choices, variety, cut and sews, tipping, lot of embellishments. Now, any garment manufacturer sitting in this hall, when they see an additional seam, he is getting worried because you need an extra operator. And where is the operator? So with the fashion coming in, the workload in the shop floor, in the manufacturing floor, has really increased. And we are in a situation that we are not having enough people to do that. In the past, the skill requirements was you are okay with the skills because a basic shirt has a certain fixed operations, and you train them, and 365 days you do the same basic shirt. Today it's not like that. The lines keep on changing every day. Within the day, the lines do many styles. So the operator who was doing an operation may not be doing the same operation in the second hour or the third hour. So the skill requirement has become very big. And how do the operator get the skill? Somebody has to train. Where do we get the people? The people used to come. In the past, they used to migrate to cities like Bangalore, because I am talking about Bangalore because I am from Bangalore. They used to migrate to Bangalore for a livelihood, take a rented place, 3 or 4 people from the family stay in a rented house and work in a company, so that was giving them enough livelihood. Today, there are a lot of rural employment opportunities created, and most of them are going back. So when we have a desire that we want to increase the capacity, we want to grow our business, but people are shrinking, so how do we handle this? Added to that, the kind of people we were employing in the apparel industry about a decade back, they have a lot of alternate jobs available. If you walk into any of the retail stores, you can see that a lot of them are working there, and they are quite happy in the environment because the atmosphere within a factory and in a retail store is different. The retail store is very lively, customers walk in, there is a lot of happening in that place. So if you ask every tailor or every operator working in your company, between a choice within a factory and in a retail store, a majority of them will say that, I want to go to the retail. So they are also taking a lot of people from our industry. There is a demand supply chain mismatch. With this, our company thought about what are the key differentiators which we can offer to the market so that we can win in this kind of situations. So obviously, we need to give high quality, shorter lead time, smaller runs and flexibilities. And I have another issue also. When most of your buyers are from abroad, I have my buyer sitting in Bangalore itself, because I produce for my own company, who is sitting in Bangalore. So the buyer is there in front of you, and he demands the quality, the lead time, the runs. So if I have to survive in this industry, I need to be the best in all. So what did we do? We did process modifications. We went into, when I say lean, it is not the perfect lean. I am saying the modular manufacturing, because lean has a lot of meaning, and we have not reached there. We are still miles away from that. We invested in technology. We have done demand supply chain integration within the company, because there is a marketing company and there is a manufacturing company, so there was a lot of integration where we manufacture after getting the orders from the market. So in those kind of things, your delivery lead time is very limited, and you have to give the specific number on the exact day at the store what is designed. How do we win employees? When employees have other choices, what do we do to win employees? We need to improve the engagement levels in the factory. We need to have an environment of recognition. Just giving salary and asking them to go at 5 o'clock or 5:30 is not enough, because they need to be recognized. So salary is not the only motivator for somebody to come and work in a company. Higher compliance. We have initiated a lot of structured people engagement programs. I will cover that a little later when I go down in my presentation. and we also, as all of us do, we also do a lot of third-party certifications. It is not merely for the compliance part. Today the mantra is that how do you excel, go beyond the compliance part. How do we remain competitive, be cost competitive, better realization of Fabric and other teams? We need higher productivity, higher machine utilization. We need superior value added products. I'm skipping this, this already covered. Now, who is our operators? Most of our operators come from the villages in and around Bangalore. When they stop their education, or when they are forced to stop their education after 10th, the option available is go to a factory and work. But the responsibility each of them shoulder is very, very huge. I'm not generalizing, but in some of the cases we found that the father doesn't work. She has to shoulder the younger siblings. So she is supposed to work from the age of 18. And when the teenagers and the young people in today's world, when they are having a different life, what is this girl coming and doing in her factory? She is sitting on the machine and doing from 9 to 5:30. Stitching, because you have a target to meet that. So how can you bring some happiness into her life? The People Engagement Initiatives plays a lot of role here. And we have a lot of welfare officers whose job is not ensuring welfare alone. They actually do People Engagement Initiative, which normally you see in an IT company where, you know, birthday celebration, small games, etc. like that. So we do a lot of that to keep these girls engaged. This is the business plan of our company. You can see in a year of 6 years, company has put an ambitious business plan of moving from 1,000 crores to 6,000 crores. Now, anybody who is having money can invest in retail, start enough showrooms. Customers are there. Fortunately, the Indian customers are having the money power to buy. But the back end, somebody need to produce this. And it is a strategic decision of our organization that whatever manufacturing is happening for the business in the front end should be done through Madura Clothing. That means Madura Clothing has to ensure that this merchandise is delivered at the time, at the cost what they want. So the pressure which is coming on our way is quite huge. And when the business is growing at a CAGR of 30%, are we able to put in capacities to meet that requirements? So what are the options? Some of the topics which was discussed in yesterday's meeting about technology, about improving productivity, it's all relevant for our company. So we need to match the expansion to match the business growth. The key resource is human resource. And if you take the manufacturing alone, the labor cost is around 60-65%, which may differ from area to area, but largely it's there. There is a pressure on availability of operators. And more than that, it used to take about 10 weeks to train an operator, because when the production manager comes to the shop floor, or he knows that operator doing a sleeve attach is not coming from next week. She is getting married or she is changing her home. Now, if the poor guy has to get a replacement, he need training for 10 weeks. This was the reality. Thank you. It's okay. There is pressure on trainers, because when the number of operators required are more, the number of trainees are more, obviously you need more trainers also. When, if you go to the shop floor and ask your production manager to release 4 or 5 people as trainers, he will not give, because obviously those are the people who are very critical for him to to balance his production. So you need to develop trainers for that. And gone are the days when the best tailor become the trainer. No, the trainer need a lot of other skills also. So with this problem, before I go into that, you know, just to let you understand the kind of pressure on the training centers, with an attrition of about 6%, we had the need of training 156 trainees, and which when you take about 10 weeks time, so every month a 156, another 156, and another 78, about 390 people you have to train, because in the all the situation when you are having a 10 weeks training time. Now, training, yesterday we had a question, is training a cost or a thing? Yeah. When you start training, it's a cost, because you need machine, you need people, you need trainers, but later the cost will become an asset. Because of the shortage of number of trainers, the trainers were compelled to handle more number of trainees due to the longer duration of time. The higher training cost obviously come as a cost to the organization. How do we win in this situation? I am very sure that this question was there in the mind of all of you sitting here. We were fortunate that we got the solution. Our visits to OGTC actually had been a helping hand in this thing. 2 years back, when we attended the conference, we knew about the 3G training, which the OGTC has introduced through RBC. And without taking time, we immediately started the training, because I don't know whether ours is the first training, but Mr. Paul Collier was in our factory training our people in March 2011. So far we had conducted two training programs, one in 2011 and one in 2013, this year. Now this is where the critical you know, the implementation strategy which has to be evolved here, because every year we get a lot of expertise from a lot of professionals and consultants from all over the world. Now they are all coming and telling us something which they had gained over a period of 20, 25, 30, maybe more than that, and we think that we can learn it in a week's time or a 2 weeks' time. You are seeing the tip of the iceberg only. So we have strategically decided that the senior members of the management sit through the program completely, switching off the mobile phone, cancelling all other assignments. So the entire 2 weeks when Mr. Paul Collier and RBC was doing the training program, we all sat through the program along with our industrial engineers, along with our trainers, and along with our trainees. So that made us understand what each of the words Mr. you know, the experts were saying. I will come across some of the words. In 2013, when Mr. Paul Collier came back for the second session, our operators told him the same words. And you can imagine, when an English man talked to people who talk Kannada, so the first 2 days, it was my responsibility to translate, because I can speak English and Kannada. But by the second day, I found out that they don't need a translator, because Paul started understanding Kannada and people started understanding English. So I'll be going into the details of the training program. And along with that, there is a refinement in the recruitment process also, which also I will be explaining what is training? I had this question, because when I was putting the presentation, I had this question, what is training? And you know, every people will tell different question. Now this is what Wikipedia says, so and if you look into the words, a lot of words are there, And that verse has a lot of meanings also. So I'm not reading that. You can read that. Basically, the knowledge and skill is transferred from a trainer to the trainee. That is what actually doing as a transaction. But how do you do that? How do you get the benefit of that? How much the trainee receive? How much the trainer is able to translate? Now, who is a trainer? A trainer is a person who trains. Now the question, the topic which was given to me is 3G trainer. So now most of you might have asked this question. What is a 3G trainer? So a 3G trainer is somebody who can achieve the targets of quality, quantity and time within the shorter span of time. In that context, the presentation goes. I think Mr. Dr. Rajesh Beda will agree to this presentation, this one, because I'm not an expert in defining what is a 3G trainer, but this is what I am putting as a context in my presentation. So you need raw material, you need machine, you need man, you need knowledge and skill. And what you expect is quality, quantity and time. One of the catchwords after the 3G program is QQT. Every operator, every trainer, every industrial engineer of our organization, remember that word. Because normally when you talk about targets, people either talk about the volume, the quantity, how many pieces. But the training has given us this. Manisha says that, you know, I have about 30 years experience, but till the training of RBC happened, I was not remembering these three words. I was remembering only targets. I used to ask people how much we produce, what is the efficiency. But that QQT is now known to everybody because the supervisor or the trainer know that it is not quantity alone. You have to deliver the other two also at the same time. So that has to be inbuilt into the training. Now, this is the second series of words which the program tells. Show, tell, check, understanding. Now, some of you who had seen this training program, you will remember this. Now, why I'm saying is that some training which happened 3 years back, why is it still there in the head? Because of the way the training program is conducted. When the coach repeatedly say, show, tell, check understanding, a person who doesn't know English understand that. They repeat that. My trainers, when they go to the show floor, I had seen telling the people, when they stand in front of a trainee, they will not be using the Kannada word. They will be saying QQT. They will be telling somebody, because if you find that another trainee, a junior trainee or somebody like that, you know, so there is a hierarchy, because somebody who is responsible for the overall training also. I had seen the senior trainer going and telling the trainee that show, tell, check understanding. Now, these are all registered in the head. And I have very great regards to that training program, because something which, if you could learn, these are all basic, which you could learn after working in the industry for about 25, 27 years. And if you are still carrying that, that is something, you know, when you go to each of the workstations, when you go to each of the operator, you will remember these words. And you will not look at only the Q. You will definitely look at the second Q. And you will also look at the T. So these are certain things which comes along with the training, and you make it as a part of your you know, daily in the job. Every engineer who join in our company is sent through this training program. So they start with that, because their first year, they go through the ATC, we call it Advanced Training Center. They get trained in this methodology, so they learn it completely, and then the next 20 or 25 or 30 years which they are going to work, this is the foundation. So that is what we do. Every management training, every senior personals, you know, some of the professionals may join from other company also, they are all given an exposure about that. So every personnel in our company understand about these catchwords. these are purely technical words which comes with the 3G training. I'm not going to elaborate about that because I'm worried Mr. sometimes Dr. Baeda will put a bill to me. So what is a skill? See, there was a concept that, you know, you pick up the best trailer from your shop floor and make a trainer. That was what we all used to do a decade back. I would say 5 years back. Or now, we understand that the trainer need communication skills. Yes. It is not that you sit there and you know, show somebody that stitch like this, hey, Isakaro. It is not that. Because how much of what you tell is perceived, understood by the trainee sitting on the other side, who is a girl who has not had any engineering training, this thing. Maximum she might have gone to a school. So a person, how much she has understood. So to make that, that's a great responsibility of the trainer. She need to coach movements. She is not an industrial engineer. She need to give feedback. She is not a counselor. She need to use stopwatch. How many of us, after working in the industry, know how to use a stopwatch? She need to do that. She need to design a training program. Because the methodology talks about breaking down an operation into an operation, and then an operation into different skills. And for each of the skill, you'll have to design a training program. Who can do this? Our industrial engineers did that initially, but today I can say with pride that my trainers are able to do that because they had done those operations years before becoming a trainer. So they know. The only thing is that they may not be initially able to put it scientifically the way we want, but today they are able to do that. And you need to use records, the selection, because the selection methodology is changed, so they need to adapt to that. Training methods, training tools, effective instruction, job analysis, skill development. And what are the resources required? You need sufficient space, you need machinery, you need fabric and trims. This is one of the things which is a highlight in that. There was a time when we all train people on the leftover fabric, that is the waste fabric. I had seen the operators stitching few stitches, and then they don't have fabric to do. So what do? The trainer used to tell them, okay, open karo, or then do. Now, after the training, we understood, we made a pie chart of how much of time they are using for opening the stitches, how much of the time they are actually getting trained, how much of the time the trainer is available. So all those come as a part of the program, and which goes into your head in such a way that you will never forget about that. So that is the impact of that training program. You need support. The trainer need trainees. Support from senior leadership. When I say this, we all see training of a operator as a job which need to be handled by somebody below. But there are times when the trainer is having a problem. Trainer is not getting sufficient material. Trainer is not getting support from HR. Trainer is not able to do something as per this thing. Or a trainee is not responding the way the training graph goes. So the senior managers have to give adequate support to them. She also need the maintenance team support because many often when a new person sit and stitch, the machines can become defective, and if it is not put back properly, she cannot continue. So these are the things which are required if a trainer has to perform well. This is another one, a very beautiful one. Normally I relate this slide to when somebody go on holidays, you see a lot of this thing. So but with that interest, look into that. What are the trainers' school toolkit? Theory of instruction, workstation, cycle time graph, effective instruction, training design, There are a lot of things this trainer is expected to do. Now, how can she do that? You need the support of the industrial engineer or a senior technical officer in your company to do that. Because organizations, depending on your organization structure, will call people in different name. But in the complete chain, there are people who are doing this job. So somebody need to take care of the trainer, equip her with all these things, then only she can do this, you know, in the time frame what we expect. The program goes with induction, machine knowledge, foundation skills, operation specific skills, mock-ups, and then build stamina and graduate. We had called graduation as something which happens when the trainee reaches an 80% performance level. See, on the first day when the trainee sit on the machine, she may be interested to learn something, but over the days, over the second day, third day, fourth day, you need to keep her interest going. So what we have done is that we draw graphs of the performance, and we had even given color codes. For example, you know, somebody who is performing below 30%, then 30 to 45, 45 to 60, like that. We had given color bands. So, like the kids who go for karate, when they move from white belt to, I think the next is yellow, I don't know. Yeah. So, like that, each of the trainees is looking at, when am I going to my next belt, next card. So, that way, we keep the, you know, the interest of the trainee to do better. And that motivates them to achieve better without, you know, wasting time or without. I will give a small comparison of the conventional training and the 3G before going into that. The conventional one talks about, all of us know that the training used to happen. We used to inbuild the quality first because we all believed that if a person is able to stitch a one needle stitch with precision, he can do anything. After that, some scientific method came. Then we started drawing straight lines, you know, zigzag lines, curves, etc. So it went like that. Now, this methodology tell you, you reverse the order. You first built in the speed and then work on the quality. Now, it was something which was very difficult to digest at that time. And every forum where I presented this within our group or this thing like that, I had faced this question. How can you say that quality is secondary? Here, I am emphasizing that we are not saying that quality is secondary. We are saying that you built the speed first. The speed and quality goes together. The training program is not saying that you achieve speed, forget about quality. It's not that. You focus on getting the speed right. Our selection used to be based on finger dexterity test and color blindness. I think a lot of companies do that. But this program tell you there is something else required for a good trainer. Sorry, for a good training. Because the trainee need a trainability. Because all of us, when we sit in the classrooms, the professor will come and teach the same. But is all of us grasping it the same way? So there is difference between the people. Now the trainability assessment help you in identifying that. Who can follow instructions? It is not about how perfectly she has stitched. It is telling about whatever you are saying, how much she can receive and reproduce. So the trainability assessment gives you an opportunity to do this and select your trainees for the particular operation. Because all of us know that the operations what we do are not the same. So there are simple operations, there are difficult, there are you know, highly skilled operations. So you need people of different potential to do this. So you do a trainability assessment before into that in the new this thing. we used to do paper exercises, which we discontinued because that was taking almost a huge amount of time. Because I think it started somewhere in the early 2000s that the training became systematic, like straight lines, then the curved lines, etc., like that. So that was taking a lot of time. Then you go into the thing. Now this was the way in which we used to teach people earlier. Now here you start with the loop exercises. Now the beauty of this one exercise is that just look back into your childhood when your dad gave you a cycle or something. What is the first thing you are wanting to do? Suppose if the trainer come and say that, beta, today you learn to put the cycle in the stand and do it for the next 3 days. And tomorrow you learn, after that, you learn how to take it out of the stand. How inquisitive you will be in doing that. Now imagine a girl who is coming from the village. She might not have seen a sewing machine. She is sitting on that, and within hours, she is stitching on the machine at a great speed. Imagine about the kind of confidence you are building in that. I'm not talking about the sequence. See, one is that the training methodology wanted the speed to be built in, but I had seen the spark in the face of the operators when they see that they are doing it and running with the speed. It's a great experience seeing them. And when you see this, their confidence has improved. I have a small video on that. The audio is from Paul, so. Now the person stitching is not a trainee, it is a trainer, because we wanted to show it to the people. So we had taken, when Paul was standing there, we had taken the video. Now this level of stitching, if it is happening within the first few hours after a person sit on the sewing machine, it's a great achievement. We have gone from the conventional method to designing exercise for each of the skill to be added. So if you look in the right left side, earlier when it was taking about 10 weeks to complete the training, today we are achieving it in about 12 days. Now it is not that all operations are possible in 12 days. Depending on the complexity of the operation, there are time differences which I'll be covering in my further presentations. How did we go about with the implementation? We understood the challenges because we have 5 factories located in different parts of Bangalore. People from about 70 villages are coming. Their culture is different. The language is same, but the culture is different, because from village to village, the culture is different. So if you have to implement a program in 5 locations, which is in different place, you need a central team to do that. So that is what we did first. We formed a team under the industrial engineering department. We had identified the trainers from each factory who all attended the RBC 3G training program. And we had put industrial engineers in charge of that, whose job was to do this alone. Please remember that when you want a focused implementation, and if you expect your industrial engineers to run after the operation breakdown of the new style which is coming in, he cannot dedicate his time. He will show his face and then he will go away with that. So we had decided that till this program is successfully implemented, these people are not touched. Grading of all operations in the product. Here what I am showing is the trouser operation. There are many operations which you classify into A+, A grade, B grade, like that. So we classified the operations because this was required for the selection of the trainee based on the trainability assessment. Obviously, in the trainability assessment, whoever is coming into the A grade has to go for the difficult operations. So the entire model was done for all the products because our company makes shirts, trousers, and suits. We had asked the industrial engineers to sit and prepare the document because the training, when the training come to you, you get a generic view because the 3G trainer, when RBC or Paul Collier do that, they cannot do it in greater depth depending on your product. So they will give a conceptual idea from which you will have to generate your own documents. So our industrial engineers spent weeks in preparing the documents. For example, each of the operations when you take, what is the purpose of that? What is the seam margin? What is the seam length? Because all these are relevant while designing the exercises. So how do you do that? It's a single burst straight smooth seam and the machine is 3/3 overlock. Number of exercises for doing that operation. So how many exercises? These are all designed by our industrial engineers. And imagine the kind of effort you have to put in, because when you say shirt, a shirt is not a shirt. A shirt is more than 3,000 SKUs. When I say better, everybody will understand when I say gold seals. Yeah, SKUs are something different, but we do, our company across the different brands, they do a lot of gold seals. So which are really different and having a lot of varying operations. So you have to make a lot of exercises like this, which is a huge project work. So what we have done is that when we recruited the batch of engineers, the fresh engineers, we had put some of the senior industrial engineers, and this was the induction assignment we gave to them so that the people are focused in that. People were, because a graduate which is coming from a fashion technology college, they know operations. The only difference is that every factory will be doing the construction in a slightly different way. So whatever is the construction happening in our organization, based on that they design this. Preparation of exercises, fabric dimensions. We had even drawn CAD drawings for the fabric dimensions because you cannot send an email and say that I need 100 meters of fabric for doing the training, because fabric is money. It's accountable, because in an ERP environment, when you have every meter of fabric coming in through the ERP, it has to go out through the ERP that way. So the industrial engineers and the CAD department work together, design the exercises, the dimensions, like, you know, 10 by 10 by 30 or 10 by 90, like that. So then they had done the CAD drawing to see, to communicate that this is the meterage we require for this exercise. So if I have to train an operator in this particular operation, I need so much of fabric. So this is, I'm sorry, may not be able to read it fully, but I will explain what it is. For example, here the side seam operation of a trouser is what is elaborated here. Now we had listed out the skill requirement on the left side, and we had given the seam layout, how it is done, and what are the skills required for doing that, how many exercises are required for that. For example, the first one is 25 centimeter single burst straight seam. So you give a rectangular piece of 7.5 centimeter into 25 centimeter, and the first thing you are asking the trainee is to stitch straight seam. So somebody who is doing a side seam operation, in the earlier training methodology, we might not be doing this. We will be asking her to stand near an operator who is doing a side seam operation, and maybe the first few days she will be only seeing. Now, how many hours you can look at this and see? So the operator stand near a operator. So physically she is standing there, but she may not be seeing many of that. So this level of detailing we had done for the entire operations in our products, shirts, trousers, and suits. What are the challenges faced during the implementation? One second. Thank you. But I think the audience will be with me. What are the challenges faced during the implementation? One, the resistance from operators due to the grapevine interaction, because you are not starting a factory new. You are running a factory which was there for the last 20 years. When the operators go to the canteen or when they go to the general area, the old operators used to tell them, we used to learn this by 2 months. You people are getting taxed by learning in learning it in 1 week. So, which was a very big issue, because the trainees used to come back and say that senior operators told this in the past, you used to take 2 months to train this. Now you are forcing us to learn it in 1 week. Now how do you handle this? Again, our HR welfare offices had a very big role to play here, because this is not the question of giving orders. This is not the question of giving SOPs. This is the question of winning the heart of the people, winning the mind of the people. Again, they narrated the real life situations. I said an example of a cycle earlier. When your dad bought you a cycle, how long are you willing to wait to take a ride and show your friends that I can ride the cycle in one hand or even without hand? So you are eager to do that. So when a trainee sits in a machine, the trainee also have an eagerness to learn it and produce like an experienced operator. The trainee is not coming from her home thinking that I'm a trainee, I'll get my trainee wages for 2 months, so I will start producing quality this thing after 2 months. Nobody is deciding like that. The trainee comes with a clean mind. What to do, how to do, when to do, it is our job. How we communicate that. So our HR department played a very great role in convincing that and killing the grapevine. Obviously, the senior operators had, because I won't say that they had done it purposely, because it happens, because most of the time we also tell that when I was studying in college, we were not having a pants, because I remember when I studied in college, in those times, very few people wear pants, because in Kerala, I'm from Kerala, the dhoti and the shed was the style when we were in college. Then slowly one or two pants came. Now today if you go to any college campus, can you see a dhoti? No. So the things are changing, the culture is changing, the technology is changing, so there has to be a speed. So we did counseling for the older operators also, why is it required? There are times when we need to dispatch an order in time and the senior operator come and say that I need leave tomorrow because of some local festival. So unless the people come back and do this, you cannot do that. So we convince the senior operators why is it required. Yeah, I'll rush it, because I initially thought it's something like that. The operator has fatigue due to the monotony, because on the first day you are asking her to sit and do that. So how do you do this? We introduce stress busters games, personal counseling. The operators were allowed to play during the in between that, because it is very difficult to sit on a machine and stitch for 8 hours when you are new. The trainers had doubt. The trainers who earlier trained in the older method, they had doubt. Is it possible? Is it can be done? So a lot of confidence building was done by the senior management. Senior management spent time with the trainer and the trainee, and we had an MIS, daily tracking of the MIS, and any factory which is lagging behind or any factory where you find the kind of growth what you required, the senior management go visit and sort it out. We had started KPIs like, you know, the number of trainees graduated in 12 days as a percentage of the number of trainees joined. Every factory started tracking this. The number of training in each of the operations also started. This is the MIS, I'm skipping this. And we crashed it. this is one slide to show you what are the benefits the company got. The training period, the what you see in the red color was the training curve, which was earlier, which is 10 weeks. Now the training is completed in 2 weeks, and then the yellow color, that is the time when the operator is actually producing for you. This is the statistics of how many number of people, number of trainees got trained in the year FY12, FY13, and we expect about 1,000 this year because of the growth what we are planning. This is the number of days which a side pocket fold and sew operation was taking. From 51 days it has gone to 11, from 52 to 12. So a focused action can actually bring it down. The benefits to the employees, their career growth has accelerated, because normally they have a career path of trainee, then skilled operator, multi-skilled operator, floater, like that. So that accelerated.
No worries, we can put it in a CD and distribute it out. Thank you so much, Devdas. I think it was really an eye-opener to see how you've been able to shrink your training time from 10 weeks to 2 weeks. I've visited their factory a few times, and it's something to be seen. I'd advise anybody who's in the garment business to look at the level of efficiencies and what they're doing in the organization, not just efficiencies alone, but the kind of CSR activities they're doing and employee building, motivation. And Devdas has played a pivotal role. We are in a very unique position. We've got the guru, Mr. Dr. Bheda here, whose training program and Paul Collier's training program Devdas was talking about, and we've got the Shisha. So I will now open this floor to questions. Anybody has any questions, and we can do one or two, and then we can break off for tea. You need a mic.
Engagement initiative which you take during your training is done by the same central team of trainers, or you bring in outside or your HR people to do that?
We have a retail company. The manufacturing company, and we have a retail company which is called Madhya Fashion and Lifestyle, and we have a lot of HR initiatives, which is normally what you see in the IT companies. In tune with that, we designed programs for this, because the kind of program that will create interest in the rural population and the urban population is different. So we use the expertise of those HR personnels, and they trained our welfare officers and HR personnels. And it's all, you have seen that matchsticks, etc., like that. These are all things which was specifically designed for them. It's not the trainer, it's the HR team.
Anybody has anything else? All right, well, Devdas is going to be around, so maybe when he's out for lunch or something, we can catch up with him. Anybody has any specific questions with that? We'll wind up this morning's session. I just wanted to thank Devdas and Mr. Merchant is not here, for a very wonderful, very informative session. And with that, we'll break for lunch. Oh, we have tea, sir. I'm already hungry.